Last lesson, we did a brief introduction to the Research Methods module, but now we're actually going to delve into the content of the module, looking at the first of the two main perspectives on researching sociology. So today we're going to look at a view which says that sociology can stand amongst the other sciences in the great scientific tradition of the Enlightenment. They would argue that sociology can make real social facts that can be used to shape society in a way that rids it of any kind of social ill. Today, we're going to look at the positivist view of sociological research. Good afternoon. So today we're going to look at our first perspective on how we should research sociology. It's important to do these first because then we can kind of fit all of the methods into which theory they might correspond with. So our first theory we're going to look at is the theory of positivism. Now, positivism comes from that kind of 19th century scientific enlightenment period. And basically they would argue that, you know, just as you can in the natural sciences make kind of reasonable, predictable laws, such as if you boil water beyond 100 degrees, that it will turn to gas, it will boil. Just as you can make predictable laws of science in the natural sciences, you can also do that with human behaviour. Now, that means that you can treat sociology just like any other science, essentially. That's its most basic understanding. So we're going to look through some of their kind of main beliefs and some of their main concepts, and think about how they would go about researching sociology. Positivists would argue that just like the products of the natural world, such as cells or natural phenomenon, human beings should be directly observed in order to identify the natural laws which govern human behaviour. Durkheim called these natural laws which govern all human behaviour social facts. These are laws which shape and determine human behaviour almost universally. From a positivist perspective, our behaviour can be directly observed and measured, much like a cell in a petri dish. Our behaviour and actions are simply the result of society's structure. Therefore, you can quite easily pinpoint how the structure is shaping the behaviour. Because they see research in this way, most positivists tend to be structural theorists, such as functionalists, Marxists, or feminists, looking at the big picture and how it's influencing the human beings within society. They would argue that individual choice and free agency are basically illusions, that actually society guides individuals in certain directions almost against their will. We are simply just acting in accordance with the various stimuli that society presents us, just as cells in a petri dish react to its environment. So, because we are controlled and regulated by society on the whole, human behaviour is predictable. It's because of this that positivists argue that we can observe behaviour by identifying patterns and trends, particularly in data. From observing data and from hard evidence, we can establish causal relationships. These are general laws of cause and effect, which we can use to identify the causes of behaviour. So one of the main concepts that we need to kind of unpack from all that is the concept of a causal relationship. Now, a causal relationship just means a relationship between a cause and an effect. This comes from the natural sciences. You know, just like my analogy to the boiling water, you know, you heat water beyond 100 degrees, that causes the water to boil or to turn to gas.
Yes, science!
So, you know, we can take a cause and effect relationships that we know from the sciences, that we know from, you know, basic biology or basic physics, and we can actually apply those to sociology. Now, it's not difficult to see, actually, there's many theories where you can see a lot of these positivist attitudes coming in. So, for instance, if we take Marxism or we take functionalism as a good example, they would argue that there is a direct causal relationship between, say, the breakdown of the two-parent family and the breakdown of primary socialisation being the cause, with an increase in things like depression and crime being the effect. The way that they kind of come to these causal relationships is when they begin to use research methods which are very based on statistics. So let's take the New Right, for instance, which would kind of come from that positivist tradition. They would argue that if you were to correlate crime rates, again using statistics, with the rate of single motherhood, that there is a direct link there. So they would say, causal relationship, the single motherhood increases crime in a specific area. So they would kind of try and make a lot of these correlations in the data, just like you would in any kind of natural science. Because positivists are on the lookout for causal relationships and absolute truths of human behaviour, they favour systematic and reliable research methods. This allows for consistency in data and quite easy verification of data. This allows them to draw large amounts of evidence and large amounts of data because reliable and systematic research methods are easily repeated. And if data can be repeated over a large number of people, then that means that you can make bold statements which explain human society. This then means that you can cure social ills, because if you can identify the cause and effect of a social problem, then that means that you can alter that cause to address the problem. This is why governments tend to favour positivist research, as its findings can be used to improve society. The positivist approach is seen as ideal, as the findings created a kind of objectivity and value freedom. Positivist sociologists are not allowed, in other words, to take subjective feelings into their research. They would generally argue that personal opinion and personal bias should be avoided, just as you would expect people to do in the natural sciences. So with all of this in mind, positivist sociologists would favour more structured research methods because they don't allow for any kind of subjective input, and they also allow for easy replication and easily repeated studies. So a couple of examples that we'll look at later, they would argue that structured questionnaires and structured interviews allow for an easy gathering of data over a large number of people. That allows for people to draw in data and to therefore make correlations which lead to causal relationships and absolute truths. So I'm going to introduce you now to two of the main and most important concepts of the whole research methods module. And that is the concepts of reliability and validity in relation to sociological research. Now, you may have heard these words elsewhere, but in slightly different contexts. And we have to remember that sometimes in sociology, things can have their own kind of sociological definitions, and exactly the same thing applies here. So when we talk about reliability, we want research to be easily repeatable so that we can test it for consistency, that we can make big overarching claims, that we can look at the big picture. Just like you would in the natural sciences. Remember, they're getting a lot of their inspiration here from things like biology. You know, you don't want to do an experiment that you can only do once with any kind of meaningful reliability. So when we say reliability, we mean something that can be easily repeatable and something which is going to get relatively similar results each time. You know, things like statistics, or kind of large-scale questionnaires, or structured interviews where you're asked the same question each time. All of those are kind of reliable methods that are going to get relatively similar results each time. You're not going to get kind of any
major differences depending on which interviewer that you provide. When it comes to questionnaires, you want to make sure that all of the questions are rigid, that they don't kind of change. Because again, you want the same experiment repeated each time. The other, not the necessarily the opposite, that's the wrong word, but something which is often seen in conflict with reliability is the concept of validity. This means kind of accuracy and depth of information. So how much meaningful information can you gather from a particular method? So let's take the positivists. Positivists would say that reliability is more important. That's the more scientific side of that kind of debate, because they would rather that a scientific study be easily repeatable so that then it can be spread across a large number, rather than a really in-depth study of something that might be valid but you would never be able to repeat it, you know. So take the interview example. Positivists would argue that you want to really make that interview structured, that it's the same question to each person that you interview, that it's the same set of questions. Otherwise, you've made an unreliable study. However, interpretivists, and so we'll look at this more in detail next lesson, would argue that actually you want it to be unstructured. You want to be able to expand on questions if maybe the person that you've asked the question to doesn't give you the full story. So you want to be able to kind of ask follow-up questions. You want to be able to ask questions that are tailored to the individual, because then you can get more valid, more depth of information. But then positivists would argue that that means that you can't then turn that into statistics. You can't make any kind of meaningful percentages out of your questions if they're the different questions to each person. They would rather sacrifice validity so that you can have a reliable system of questioning that can later be turned into statistics, which can then be turned to make those causal relationships.
Not only do positivists value reliability in their research methods, but they also prefer representative data. This means a large gathering of data on a target population. They would not want a small-scale study that draws a lot of data from a small number of people. They want a large study which looks at a big number of people, because then that allows for bold generalizations to be made about groups within society, drawing those causal relationships that they can then use to try and cure any social ills or social problems. These generalizations develop from the use of objective research methods such as structured observations, questionnaires, and statistics. These methods create quantitative data, which is data which is numerical, essentially number-based. This allows for patterns and trends to be established. Quantitative data is often contrasted with qualitative data, which is more word or image based. Positivists would argue that quantitative data, or numerical data, is what you should value, because that means that you can make broader, more representative patterns and trends, and it means that you can draw correlations. So in terms of our final thoughts then, it's just probably best that we summarise positivism, that we recap a few bits. I understand it's a lot of information to take in at first. Bear in mind that as we go through a lot of these research methods, we'll be thinking about which side that it falls into. But generally, in summary, positivism would argue that we need to treat sociology like a science, that we need to try and find natural social facts that exist in society, that there are actual conclusions that can be drawn that apply to the big picture. Yes, it might be more valid to get information, say, from, you know, a particular individual or a small group of people, but to be really useful in society, this is kind of the kind of positive side of positivism, if you like, We need to apply the big picture. You know, we need to recognise that you need to apply scientific method of reliability, of structured questionnaires, structured interviews, you know, things which allow you to gather data, because that is what you can then use to influence policy. That's what you can then use to make big understandings of the world around you. You know, there are social facts that you can draw from society. So next lesson we'll look at kind of a lot of the criticisms that come of positivism, and that is going to be from the interpretivist side of things, and they're very opposite in a lot of ways. But do you start to think about what kind of methods might fall into that kind of scientific side of things that the positivists would enjoy?